The ForAc project has been a very intense less than 3 years. We got funded in late 2020 and had to start really very much from the go, working very hard on this. We've had a great team of people working on this project, some of which you, or many or several of which you see here up in front. The project has, as I said, been based at the University of Turku, but we have had very close cooperation with FIA, the Finnish Institute of International Affairs, from the start as well. So the acronym stands for Foreign Acquisitions and Political Retaliation as Threats to Supply Security in an Era of Strategic Decoupling. And if you're interested in finding out more about us and our research products, what we have produced during these years, you can always look at the website, which is up here. We started out with a very sort of broad, overarching societal concern before we thought of actually the specific research questions. So there was a debate at the time that we wrote the application about how that sort of we understood as being, how can small open economies shield their enterprises that are critical for their supply security from strategic foreign acquisitions and political retaliation, while still maintaining their open economies? It was a bit of a dilemma. And this debate was very much sort of revolving around an influx of Chinese investments that we saw in Europe starting from about 2015, especially 2016, 2017. So there was concern that this is not a level playing field for us, because we have a very large economy, a party state that has perhaps tighter control of its enterprises, enterprises that are endowed with a lot of capital, and we have fairly open economies, so it's easier to come in and buy up companies that are small, medium-sized. If there is the will, the strategic intent, and the capital, so it's easy to come in and buy these companies. So what are we as small open economies, the likes of Finland, Sweden, the Netherlands in the past? We thought mainly about the Nordic countries here, but it will be relevant also for other similar economies. What are we supposed to do about these things? Should we just kind of close the possibility to buy these companies through legal or whatever policy means, or how should we balance our open economies and the wish to maintain them with not sort of giving away what might be very critical enterprises for us. So from this very broad societal concern, we drew three more specific research questions. So we had a bundle of things that we needed to understand or wanted to understand in order to respond to this sort of broader societal concern. Firstly, what forms does China's economic statecraft typically take? Was the one that we started out with and we worked on, especially in the early part of the project. Secondly, what kinds of Nordic enterprises are particularly vulnerable to strategic acquisitions by state-linked actors? And how can such threats be identified early? And finally, and this is the part that we have been working now on, especially in the latter part of the project, and the report that you have, I think, all seen. It's available here, free copies. It's also available on the web. Is responding to this last question in particular. So how can societal resilience towards detrimental state economic influence efforts be strengthened? Along the way, we kind of broadened a little bit the focus to not be just about China. We framed it in the sense that we're talking about how can small states with open economies, deal with what major states are able to do. And you will hear more about that in the later presentations. So major states in this case are mainly then China and the United States, that have a lot more sort of tools and ability to shape the system in many ways, whereas small states like Finland mainly adapt or respond and try to do what they can to shield themselves. So the research framework, which is also found in the report, is depicted in very simple terms in this figure or picture that you see here, where on the left-hand side, the state A, that refers to a major state, such as China or the US or some other, perhaps a major state that is in a similar position, but mainly China and the US, that has the ability to do something vis-a-vis state B, which in this case is a smaller state entity. Either directly through various forms of economic statecraft, or it may also target the enterprises of this state through various forms of, for example, sanctions or pressure or so on. Whether or not this is a concern hinges at least on a couple of different things. The modes of control that state A has over its enterprises is clearly a relevant factor. So is state A able to control its companies and direct them towards doing certain things? How does it control these companies is a relevant factor. And obviously also in the smaller state, is the targeted company that may be the target of a strategic acquisition, is it relevant for that country's security of supply? And here, for those of you, I mean, many of you are familiar with this, but for those of you who are not familiar with it, when we talk about security supply issues in a state like Finland, a lot of it is actually the private sector that is responsible, or at least plays a major role here. So if the state was taking care of everything there, maybe it wouldn't be such a problem. But if we have enterprises that are important and integral for providing actually in practice these things, then it becomes more of an issue. I hope you can see some of this at least in the back of the room as well. So we have produced a number of articles that are openly available on the web, and you can find them also on our website. And so one part of the project was really to think through the various forms of economic statecraft that China uses. But it actually turned out the more we discussed this, the more we dealt with this issue, that it's even broader than just economic statecraft. Economic statecraft is just a part of it. So we ended up with this paper that came out just a few months ago together with Matt Furchin, who's at Yale University. Unfortunately, Matt wasn't able to join us today, but together with Matt, we wrote this paper where we talked about five modes of economic influence that China is able to wield. I'm not going to go through all of it, but a few points that you may take note of. We used actually, or further developed, a framework that was originally proposed by Evelyn Goh, but she talked about the first three of these in a non-economic context and in Southeast Asia. So ATP, ability to prevail, is what you might think of as coercive economic power, coercive diplomacy, sticks, if you will. Then you had a preference multiplication, which is more the sort of the carrot side of things, and then you had persuasion. But she wrote about them in a non-economic context and specifically in a region. So we thought it was a good starting point, and we broadened up that framework more to focus on the economic side and added to new modes of economic influence, informality and unintentional influence. I think the key point here is that a lot of the debate that we see, that we hear in the media all the time, just about every day you open up the media, you hear about something related to these things, is focused on the first one, the ATP here. Sticks, the coercive power. That's the most visible one. That's the one we note China uses or restricts, for example, trade to Australia, or shows its displeasure with Lithuania or something like sort of the Czech Republic. That's the one that we note. But we are saying that way too much actually energy and effort goes into this debate in these. And they are not that effective, actually. They work less well than is frequently assumed. I mean, most of these countries have not changed to a significant degree their policies just because China has used these kinds of measures against them. They tend to focus on OECD countries and firms. And when they're directed against firms, they may be a bit more efficient or work well better than with sovereign countries. But what we are saying is that this is actually way too much debated. It's more interesting to look at these, the carrots and persuasion. The reason maybe that we don't note them so much is that we are not the primary targets usually for that. It's the global south or developing countries, whatever you want to call, but outside of the OECD framework usually. And there the story tends to be quite different and you see different kinds of modes of influence used by China. I'm not going to go more into informality and unintentional here, but it's a very mixed picture. And the debate focuses a bit, in our view, on the wrong things often, and we miss something as a consequence. In addition to these modes of influence, there is a sixth way in which China exercises influence as well. And here you can draw maybe a little bit of a parallel to the United States in the early 20th century, when it was not yet the biggest sort of global political power, but it was already a very significant economy. It was something to take into consideration. It affected things already by the mere presence of its economy. So China tends to do things differently from what at least the so-called Washington consensus was supposed to be, sort of how we thought about what you're supposed to do in the global economy, what the global economic governance norms were. Of course, the norms in general and norms in the global economy are never settled. They're always contested. That's just a basic fact. So they're always going to be in flux and contested, never sort of ultimately settled. So, but we had maybe a little bit of a notion of how you're supposed to run countries' economies and the global economy. And for example, for a moment, we thought of that there should be conditionality in development assistance. We thought that it was good to have convertibility of a currency, a free capital account, especially if you want to be included in the IMF's special drawing rights. We thought that an open trade regime was a good thing, that upholding market competition is a good thing. And there was a relatively clear distinction between what was state, what was private, at least in, for example, the WTO context. But China has challenged all of these in various ways, not necessarily because it intentionally wishes to do so, but because it has organized, it has a different political economy, and it does things in different ways. So we have now alternative norms, in a way. No upfront or few upfront aid conditionalities, aid being an integral part of a package of broader investment and trade relations. We now kind of accept that it's certain capital controls may be appropriate. Protectionism in strategic industries is gaining ground as a notion. Active industrial policies, and it's less becoming less and less clear what is or should be the boundary between state and private. So, I mean, if you just look at the discussions in the US, in EU, in the EU, in the recent 2 years, it's starting to sound very much like the right-hand side of things. We're talking protectionism and industrial policy as good things, as something that is supposed to be a thing to strive for. So China challenges us. We feel sometimes maybe a little bit threatened by China as well. We feel that this is something, this is a new environment, something we need to deal with, and we are not sure what to do about it. Now, how does this link up? This might be a little bit difficult to see, but you will find it in the paper if you look it up. How does this link up to investments? Remember, we started out with sort of there was an influx of Chinese investment into Europe in 2015, 16, 17. So how does that link up with this? Well, the Nordic countries actually were the first, in a way, to introduce what we now talk of as investment screening of foreign investments. The first ones to introduce legislation on foreign investment. And it happened very early on, already in the early 20th century, and started essentially in Norway. Then Sweden followed, and a bit later, Finland as well. Denmark was the only kind of opt-out in this respect. And in this paper, what we thought was interesting was that when we looked at this, we went back to look at the debates in the 1910s, for example, the parliamentary debates in the Nordic countries. And it's striking how similar it sounds. Of course, the scare of the day was different. The scare of the day at that time was not Chinese investment. It was German investment. It was British investment into the natural resource sector in Norway or in Sweden that people were scared of. What if they come up and buy our mines and our forests and so on? So we identified four different kind of periods of legislation that, where you see parallels in the Nordic countries in different periods. So we have this, first the resource nationalism started in the early 20th century and ended roughly end of Second World War. Then we had embedded liberalism, where there was a different concern. Then the concern was mainly multinationals, most of them Americans, coming up and buying know-how, for example, in Europe. We had then the liberalization phase that started in the mid-80s and saw actually countries repealing their legislation on foreign investment. Or in Finland's case, we still had the legislation, but it wasn't very actively applied anymore in the sense that it had been, let's say, in the 70s or 80s. So it was there, but it was very narrowly focused and not very actively applied. So investments were not blocked or even very actively screened at the time. And now we have this new phase that we can call maybe geoeconomics, as you've all heard the term recently. It started roughly 2015, and now the scare has been very much related to outside of Western countries risks. So in other words, risks emanating from China. So we tried to put it in a broader historical trajectory and framework that this is not the first time that we are seeing this kind of perception of risk. And interestingly, in a lot of these cases, those risks did not materialize to the extent that they were thought to materialize. So there wasn't that much of an influx of resource grabbing German or British investors. And also there's not actually that much Chinese investments coming in now anymore, even to all of Europe. So with this opening remarks, I will hand over the microphone to our next speaker, who is probably well known to many of you. Sean Bresley, he's a professor of politics and international studies at the University of Warwick, one of the most well-known, I should say, and well-cited scholars on political economy of China in all of Europe. He's also the co-editor of the Pacific Review, and he has published numerous articles and books. His latest book came out 2 years ago with the title China Reason, Studying China's Global Power, by Bristol University Press. Sean has been acting as our scientific advisor throughout this project, and we have benefited enormously from his views and expertise throughout. So Sean is going to talk a little bit more about European perceptions of China and how they have changed over the years.
It's a long way down. Sorry. It's a long way down, actually. Before I start, I'd just like to thank you, actually, for getting me involved in this project in the first place, because I've certainly learnt a lot. It's very easy to be quite parochial and UK-based when you're in the UK, and the ability to listen to what you were doing from a distance got me through the pandemic. So I'm very glad to be here. So what I'm going to do today is just do three things, really. I'm going to focus on the speed of the transition in dominant attitudes towards China across Europe, and I'm being generalistic. I tried not to rely too much on UK examples, but I probably have too often, I'm afraid. I've also tried to identify the common themes across Europe in these changing perceptions of China as far as possible. Obviously, they depend, or they vary from country to country. And I'm going to finish off by talking about what's at stake, because getting the economic relationship right with China is hard enough. But getting the economic relationship right isn't just about the economic relationship. It's about a whole range of other things too. So what I thought I would do was, by way of preparing for the more important talks to come, I would start with a countdown. And again, apologies for perhaps too many UK examples from here. I did have more of taking them out. So I thought we'd do a countdown. And as with most countdowns, we start with 84. Because this is the year actually I first went to China, and it just simply gives me the excuse to put some photos on the screen of things that I took when I was in China. The one at the bottom left, shortly before I was had an interesting encounter with the local military for being in a place that I wasn't meant to be in. Right, so on to 83, not really, on to 10. It's only 10 years since Xi Jinping became president of China. And let's face it, it's his period that has been the focus of much of the huge transitions in opinions about China, perceptions of China. Of course, he became head of the party the previous year, but that didn't neatly fit with my 10 to 1 countdown. So I started with the period when he became president. But also, of course, it is the 10th anniversary of the announcement of the Belt and Road. And we're going to see lots and lots and lots of newspaper reports and studies about 10 years of the Belt and Road coming up over the next few months. This crops up, I think, more than anything in the account of the changing perceptions of China. Sometimes people will talk about the Made in China 2025 initiative, which was announced actually in 2015, but the Belt and Road always comes up as one of the key turning points in the way that people were looking at China and thinking about China. Perhaps not so much the Belt and Road itself, but the way that it was promoted, the message that it seemed to be giving out about Chinese intention to now try and change economic and perhaps political geographies across the world. There was a period where you couldn't really walk through London without bumping into a Chinese think tank that was over explaining the benefits of the Belt and Road. It was also the year of the Airpocalypse, 2013. I was there in Beijing at the time. Arguably, one of the best things that happened to the environmental movement was this happened in Beijing, because I'd been in places like Taiyuan in 1989, and you wouldn't have been able to see the back wall because of the pollution. But things that happen in a provincial Chinese city are rather different from things that happen in front of the politicians, and we'll come back onto this at the end of the talk, because I think it is significant. 9 is the number of years between the creation of the 14 plus 1 process in 2012, where China tried to establish mechanism for interaction, potentially influence, depending on your point of view, with Central and Eastern European countries at the far end of the Belt and Road, and the beginnings of, well, perhaps not the end, but the beginnings of significant problems with that engagement process, started ostensibly by Lithuania's focus on relations with Taiwan. So in a 9-year period, we had, if you like, peak concern about Chinese influence in Central and Eastern Europe, perhaps splitting the EU apart, towards now, I think, a widespread acceptance that that process has not achieved what it was meant to achieve. 9 years from not start to finish, but start to whatever it is that it's going to be evolving into. 8 is the number of countries in Europe surveyed by Pew that have a negative opinion of China. Only Greece has a positive opinion of the public opinion of China. You'll see, of course, that there is a great omission from the countries that they surveyed here. What I think is also quite interesting is if you look at the change over the years, Italy quite static, Greece quite static, Belgium you can't really say because of the only 2 years of it, but there are some very steep upward curves in a number of countries, some of them corresponding with each other. If you look at the Netherlands, Sweden, sort of the UK, there is a correlation there. And then if you look at France, Germany, Spain. So there are different periods and different reasons for this shift in public opinion. I think perhaps a more significant thing is that China does seem to have become an issue of public opinion and public debate in perhaps a way that it hasn't before. And certainly, if I can be parochial for a minute, that really is the case in the United Kingdom. China is being spoken about and, by people that wouldn't have even really considered it in the past. It has become an issue of daily political discourse. 7 is the number of mentions of human rights in Finland's China Action Plan of 2010, and that is there to compare with the 39 mentions of human rights in the 2021 version. And across Europe, human rights in China is sort of back on the agenda. OK, it never went away. Certainly for human rights organisations, it never went away. But for, I think, a large part of the continent and a large part of the political discourse, human rights began to disappear not too long after 1989 off the agenda, arguably too quickly. There was a period when it was really, I don't think, part of the mainstream consideration of China, but it's certainly back. This is the Finland case, but you'll find it in lots of other European countries too, of course. Is it to do with Xinjiang? Is it to do with wider controls over political freedoms? Is it to do with what's happened in Hong Kong? Perhaps a combination of all of them, but this clearly is an issue that's come back on the agenda in the way that it wasn't for a number of years. 6 is the number of years between George Osborne, the then Chancellor of the Exchequer, the Treasury Minister, who was basically running UK or a leading force in UK's China policy, visiting Xinjiang and talking about its tremendous opportunities and being praised by the Global Times for his pragmatism, the 6 years between him doing that and the British Parliament issuing sanctions on perpetrators of gross human rights violations in Xinjiang. Perhaps the UK has seen the most dramatic of U-turns in dominant perceptions of China, from the golden era of 2015 to a much more sceptical position in 2019, 20, 21. Some of it to do simply with the change of leadership, but I think it's also an example of one of the key focuses alongside human rights that has led to this shift in opinion. And 5, similarly, is the number of years between Xi Jinping becoming the first Chinese president, and he went as president, not as party leader, to the European Council, to the EU producing its famous document that tries to navigate this difficult line between talking about China as a cooperation partner, but also an economic competitor, and crucially, a systemic rival, promoting alternative modes of governance. So I would say within a period of a decade, probably within a period of 6-7 years, the dominant perception of China has shifted quite considerably in most European countries, which I think lays the foundations and the background to much of what this project has been about. I actually think we can trace it a little bit further back, and I think in a few years' time, we will need to go back and look at what happened in the global financial crisis, because I think we've still not fully played through the consequences of that crisis and what it meant for perceptions of the liberal global order and indeed perhaps the legitimacy of the liberal global order. Now, anybody who learns Chinese has to learn at some point that the Chinese term for crisis consists of two characters, Wei and Ji. Now, the Ji can mean lots of things, but one of the things that it can mean aircraft, for example, but one of the things it means is opportunity, whereas the Wei means danger. So the Chinese word for crisis is a combination of danger and opportunities. And originally, I think in 2008, there was a focus on the opportunities that China provided as a way out of the crisis. We see the European Union sending delegates to China to try and get help for the bailout of the euro, quite considerable. China was the best bet for growing out of the crisis. It was potentially a source of investment for countries that were otherwise trying to domestically impose austerity policies. In terms of trade, it was reducing the cost of a number of materials. Now, a couple of things I really want to emphasize here is that At this period, still, we often were getting the argument that interdependence and bringing China into the global, liberal global order was the best way of ensuring that China became socialized into this existing order. The best chance of peace was the promotion of the liberal project of enmeshment and engagement. And another thing we saw, I think, was China seen as a competitive opportunity. So you had, for example, Germany, Britain and France often sending delegations to China immediately after each other to try and establish themselves as China's best friend in Europe, to try and gain these competitive advantages of Chinese power in the post-crisis order. And perhaps also there was an acceptance of the limited capability of European states, either on their own or collectively, to force for change. Now, what happens, I think, is that in the years not so far afterwards, we see a shift from an emphasis on the opportunities to the dangers, with many of the same initial opportunities now seen also as the dangers. So we see perceptions of power asymmetries flipping. I think almost the minute that the plane touches down in Beijing, certainly within China, if you read any Chinese account of China's global role, they will refer to the global financial crisis as the moment that things changed. Not the end, but the beginning of the end. And a perception that power asymmetries had flipped. In a hierarchy of global powers, Europe was no longer above China, but China was now above Europe. And I think increasingly that was accepted in Europe. Continued Chinese growth, which was once seen as being a good thing for the West, was now increasingly being questioned because of the way in which this growth was being generated. Did this mean something about the Chinese model and the resilience of the Chinese model versus a Western liberal model? China as a source of investment, as we'll see, became increasingly seen as a potential problem rather than an opportunity. And trade dependencies also became a source of concern rather than a source of potential growing out of the crisis for Europe. And it's this idea of the weaponization of the interdependence that was once seen as a source of stability and peace that has been perhaps the most pronounced. And in order to have this perception of the weaponizable interdependence, you have to have a prior understanding of the nature of what it is that China is and what it wants as well. And I'll come back onto these other things here in a few minutes. But if we run through the various explanations of why perceptions changed in different countries, this list on the left more or less tells you most of what is there. Increasing Chinese confidence, self-confidence, the perpetuation of the Chinese political system, the increasing authoritarianism of the Chinese political system, new Chinese initiatives, not just the Belt and Road, Made in China 2025, but as we shall see shortly, some global governance initiatives too, all embed this idea that China is able and prepared to change the world, and this changed world probably won't be something that looks good for the existing stakeholders in the liberal international order. And of course, one of the other things was just this rapid growth of investment from China that takes place from the 2010s after the global crisis. This is the increase in direct investment into Europe in that period from 2016, when it hits a real high spot. And you see this rapidly rising amount of investment. And on the face of it, that's, you know, huge. Now, if we take a step back, it's not. If you look today to try and find where China is in a list of investors in European countries, or indeed the EU as a whole, you struggle to find it. Even if you take into account investment that flows through other places, like the Cayman Islands or the British Virgin Islands, it's actually quite difficult to find where China lies within a hierarchy of investors into Europe. In the UK, the total stock of Chinese investment as a percentage of all overseas investment is 0.3%. So here you have an idea of rapid growth. Here you have a situation that suggests that China is not as significant as it perhaps might appear at first sight. And yet it was this growth in investment that in a number of countries, I think perhaps here as well, really drove the agenda or increased the focus on what was happening with Chinese investment. Why? Maybe the speed and growth and newness of something is always going to be more politically newsworthy, politically concerning than long-term established aggregate flows, wherever it came from. Secondly, sectors. Where the Chinese money was going began to raise alarm in a number of countries. Of course, in Germany, when KUKA Robotics was bought by a Chinese company. Maybe pressure. Certainly in a number of countries, we see the United States trying to put pressure on European governments to share their view of the dangers of Chinese investment. This here produced by the Foreign Affairs Committee, basically pointing to the dangers that many in the US I think thought were being overlooked in Europe of this investment. But I think it's more to do with trust in the leadership, and it goes back to that very first slide, what's happened in China under Xi Jinping. So for China, if you have a dependence on imports, that's not a problem unless you fear that those imports will either accidentally or perhaps more often in the case of China, deliberately be disrupted for political gain. And this is, I think, what has happened. This is the key, the change. It's not necessarily, even if the economic flows hadn't changed, the perception of those economic flows would have changed because of an understanding of what the Chinese Communist Party can do, an understanding that in some respects has been forced by the Chinese Communist Party itself, trying to explain itself and its ideas and its objectives and motivations to the world, an understanding of what the CCP wants to do in terms of, for example, the Belt and Road changing economic geographies, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank being introduced to fill gaps that the Chinese wanted to fill in global economic governance. And in many cases, not just a might or what if, but increasingly it seems to me, and here I might be being too influenced by the debate in the UK, it's not just what the CCP will do, might do, it's what it will do. There's almost this understanding that there's some sort of inevitability of a change in the future that will lead to these interdependencies being weaponized, Chinese access to data and so on and so forth being utilized. And this has created the perception of China, which then shapes the perception of the economic relationship with China. And here I want to emphasize perhaps three things that I've put on that original list. The increasing Chinese self-confidence, new Chinese initiatives, and the resilience of Chinese authoritarianism have, I think, perhaps done a lot to shift this overall dominant perception. Not helped, of course, by the pandemic or indeed by China's position on the Ukraine war, where I've come up with a terminology that explains Chinese position. It is asymmetric neutrality. Now, I realize that is a contradiction in terms, but I use that contradiction in terms for good reasons. So all of these things have enhanced the distrust in China. And I wonder how far this is important. If we were talking about China in 2001, 2002, you could make the argument, and indeed the Clinton regime made the argument in China joined the World Trade Organization, that China will change. If we engage China, if we enmesh China, if we involve China, it will change. It will become socialized. It will become more like us, both as a domestic political system and also a global actor. It is very hard to make that argument today. 2018, The Economist said how the West got China wrong. Actually, in 2009, people were saying very similar things, but now it is very difficult to make the argument that engaging China will change it, or certainly will change it in the ways in which it was meant, again, air quotes, to have changed. Because China may have changed, but it's not changed to the sort of country that it could have been Authoritarian resilience. It has changed because there is this increasing self-confidence. There is a white paper produced by the State Council, China Democracy That Works, explaining how Chinese democracy is better now than Western forms of liberal democracy. This is not only a political system that has not become liberal, it has become more something else instead. And one of the things that I think has happened and that has come out of this project is sort of things we're going to hear, but also looking at the wider debate, is that there's been a bit of a bundling of concerns about China into to one concern about a China threat. Things we don't like about China. A lot of time when people are talking about the China threat and you ask them what the threat is, they then talk about the political regime in China. So things we don't like, fair enough. The second is an unspecified assumption that a rich and stronger China cannot be a good thing for the liberal world. So where is the threat? Again, difficult to be specific about it, but an understanding that it will be there. There is something about this China in the future that as it becomes richer and stronger, it will try and change the world, and that simply can't be a good thing. There are real, clear and present immediate threats. I don't know whether you've been following the news in the UK about espionage in Westminster over the last week or so, but it's, you know, it's quite clear there are things to be concerned about at the moment, very clear, immediate threats. But a lot of the debate is based on things that might become a threat if things happen in the future. So is it a problem that Chinese company owns this? Maybe not at the moment, but what if in the future the CCP gets it to do this? Is it a problem that you have so much trade with China? Well, not at the moment, but it might become a problem if things change in the future. And then there are world order type challenges as well, changing the nature of global governance and global organisation. And these things often get pulled together, I think. You hear people talking about the China challenge, and I'm not saying it's not there, but I think we need perhaps a little bit more nuance to try and identify the different parts of this challenge, the different bits that are a threat. And of course, the thing that we're going to focus on for the rest of today really is looking at the future, the things that might become a threat, because predicting the future is very difficult. Explaining the past is hard enough, but having this understanding of the future is really quite difficult too. But that seems to me to be where much of the debate in much of Europe lies at the moment. It lies about worrying about what might happen in the future if certain things happen, if certain political assumptions come true. And as I started off saying, though, this is not just about getting the economic relationship right. Let's continue with the countdown. The economic relationship is crucial. In 2021, China was the fourth biggest source of Finnish imports. I'm told it's now the third biggest source. Again, I didn't want to change it because it messed up my countdown. So I stayed with the 2021 figures. But the fact that it has changed is important. At the moment that the rhetoric, the discussion and the debate about China is getting louder and louder, actually, there aren't the signs of decoupling and de-risking that some people are talking about. We're talking about getting a relationship right with China, with a China that for most of Europe is a key source of imports. How easy is it to decouple, provide security, when the country you're trying to decouple and provide security from is such an important component of your current economic activity? We have, in third place, three global initiatives: China's Global Development Initiative, Security Initiative, and Civilization Initiative. China is trying to push, promote a different set of global norms. We might not always take them very seriously, but let me read to you an invitation to a lecture from a very prestigious African university president that I got last night, where he refers to a distant America, a condescending Europe, and an intriguing Asia at the heart of which is emerging a new vision led by China. So this is about potentially dealing with polarities that go way beyond the trade dimension of any relationship with China too. Number two in the countdown is that this is a China that is the second biggest funder of the UN in general, and specifically of UN peacekeeping operations. And in joint first place, a China that is the single biggest national source of carbon dioxide emissions and also the single biggest producer of electronic vehicles. And if we are going to have any solution to global environmental issues, we have a China that is at the same time a key part of the problem and also a key part of the potential solution. So how easy is it to reduce the economic risks of a country you're so economically embedded with, and with a country that is so important in lots of different ways to the functioning of the global order? I'm not sure whether this actually means things outside of the UK than I expected. This is a cake, as you may have noticed. UK policy towards China has been described as being cakeist, based on the idea of the English slogan of having your cake and eating it at the same time. So UK policy is cakeist because we want all the good bits of dealing with China: cooperation on the environment, cheap imports, cheap goods, resolution of conflict in other parts of the world. Perhaps China's got a role to play in Ukraine yet. But we don't want the bad bits. So can we have all the good bits, please, whilst de-risking all the bad bits? And this is what the idea of a cakeist policy is. How surgical can we actually be in taking out the risks and the dangers without potentially unravelling all those other issues that were in the countdown from 5 to 1? And I will leave that question hanging. Thank you for listening, if you have been. This is an interesting picture. It was on National Day in China in 2018. Looks very peaceful and silent. There were 2 million Chinese people standing behind me, staring at me as I took that photograph. We now move on, I think, to the more important part of the presentations this morning. Oh, no, you don't need to. I was back to the issue. So I'll let you come and do the technology. So we have two panelists and a commentator. So Alina Sinkinen, who I've known, we were trying to work out since about 2011, when she was a doctoral student, but is now senior research fellow at the Finnish Institute of International Affairs and docent in East Asian Studies at the University of Turku. She has a very impressive set of publications in leading journals, most importantly, the Pacific Review, which just happens to be the one that I edit. And then we have Lisa Kaupila. I'm apologies for my pronunciation of Finnish names. It's pretty terrible. Who is a futurist and senior researcher at the University of Turku. She's done a lot of work on China's global economic outreach, but I find your work on art and social science particularly interesting. And then as the commentator, Sirka Heinonen. And if we read out all of your achievements, we would be here for the rest of the week, I think. A very well-known specialist in future studies, particularly most recently at the University of Turku, and at the moment is running, I can't believe this, you're running 2 major research projects on future studies. Both funded by the Academy of Finland, Real Estate and Sustainable Urban Environment, and Winning Spatial Solutions for Future of Work. I mean, it's, one would be more than enough for me. So I am going to hand this over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sean, for the very kind introduction. Today's world is characterized by great power competition, as the United States and China are becoming strategic rivals in all aspects of global life. Given the simultaneous disintegration of the global governance system, technological development and preceding climate change, states must navigate in extremely uncertain and complex environments. And under these circumstances, especially small states find themselves in a really challenging position.
And without further delay, we will start this presentation by bringing to the end of the decade. Next, you will see a glimpse of what it could possibly look like if the current trends continue as usual.
News, 1st of February 2030. Political retaliation and preferential practices. Antibiotic reserves at critically low levels in Finnish hospitals.
Home at last. Tianxia, turn on the TV and switch on the sauna.
Okay, Elsa.
This is Plus News.
Finland, good evening.
Our top story today, Finnish hospitals are struggling with critically low reserves of the vancomycin antibiotic, which is commonly used to treat illnesses such as pneumonia and blood poisoning. In recent years, vancomycin has become more important due to the spread of antibiotic-resistant strains of bacteria. The Chinese-Indian supply chain for vancomycin was disrupted in last July following an explosion in a Chinese factory. Since December, Finnish hospitals have been supplied from the National Emergency Supply Agency's reserves. If the availability of antibiotics does not improve, commonly curable diseases will soon threaten human lives. There is also a risk of considerable decrease in surgical operations, as the vancomycin shortage has also increased the demand for antibiotics used in surgeries, contributing to their supply disruptions as well. Next up, we have the daily debate, in which our commentators tackle the situation.
The antibiotic industry has for a long time concentrated in the China-India axis due to the small profit margins. Western companies produce medicines for chronic diseases. We should have directed more public funds to our domestic or the EU's internal antibiotic production long ago.
In my opinion, we should have changed our public bidding rules already at the beginning of the 2020s to support the diversification of production. Back in 2020, the Commission also encouraged the development of the EU's own strategic medicine stocks to support the member states' reserves. If this had been established successfully, then...
Now look, let's not forget that Chinese hospitals have no vancomycin supply issues. It is only that its export is restricted strictly to China-friendly states. As an EU member state, Finland is suffering from the consequences of these restrictions. You could say that the EU's human rights criticism of China and its close relationship with the United States are now taking its toll.
Yeah, I'm home from work. How is it going at the hospital? Is Mira coming home today? Huh? But wasn't it supposed to be something that's easily treatable? What do you mean there's no medicine available?
Dear experts, how could this situation have been avoided?
This scenario and eight others were presented in the ForAc project stakeholder exercises that brought together over 100 experts in Finland and Sweden during 2022 and 2023. The key idea here was to present the experts with comic art format dystopias that we had created based on our research, and then ask them to imagine effective ways to prevent them from unfolding. This way, we sought to find an ideal way to tackle today's complex and cross-sectoral problems that call for skill sets of different expert groups. And we would very much want to thank all of the experts for participating, because we wouldn't have this research without your really essential contribution.
And basically, this was done according to the basic principles of the Delphi technique. Delphi is a method that is commonly used in the field of future studies, and it's designed to tackle complex problems with no right or wrong answers. In practice, our experts shared their views anonymously to make sure that it's the argument, not the status or the charisma, that counts. The experts also had a chance to read each other's views and change their original arguments. Our focus was on dissensus instead of consensus. This means that we wanted to gather a variety of alternative ways that small states can adopt in tackling risks of great power management.
Our exercises included both short and longer term scenarios, varying from 2027 to 2030 and 2035. This way we could go beyond the five-year timeline that the EU proposes for national risk assessments and to which Nordic countries generally adhere to. There are significant restrictions to what can be accomplished in 1 to 5 years, so the longer time frame allows a wider range of solutions compared to the shorter timeline. So we thought this would be a good way to do this research to complement some of the gaps that we have in our existing knowledge.
Yes, and then we chose to run the exercise in a comic art format to facilitate mental time travel and practically immerse the panelists into the future. In doing so, we had a chance to work with a very skilled Finlandia-nominated comic artist, Tuuli Hypeen, who made sure to bring the crisis to the level of ordinary people, as you could see in the introductory scenario. That way, the scenarios would activate universal feelings instead of just rational skills of experts. The comic art format also served to tackle Delphi and survey fatigue and motivate our panelists. We were very much aware that especially our Finnish panelists would be hesitant to participate in yet another Delphi survey, and that dropout rates in Delphi studies are very high.
In Finland, the experts read altogether 9 comics online in 3 sets of questionnaires, which were opened every 4 to 5 months. In Sweden, we organized a smaller on-site workshop with 2 scenarios.
So basically, the Finnish exercise was very extensive, with an overall number of 97 state officials, researchers, business people, representatives of NGOs, and politicians participating in the exercise. Whereas the Swedish workshop was smaller in scope, but it included 16 notable stakeholders, mainly from the state sector.
Our background research identified 3 key competencies of great powers, those of investment leverage, supply chain dominance, and core technology control, which you can see on the left side, each of which is associated with a key small state vulnerability, those of supply risks, security risks, supply disruptions, and critical technological dependencies on the right side. These 3 categories formed the structure of the exercise.
And on the first row there, the category of security risks forms a broad group of potential dangers to which small states' national and supply security systems are exposed because of great powers' investment leverage. In practice, great powers have greater resources to make investments. And that's why they may achieve effective control over companies and real estate that can be utilized to advance their own foreign policy aims. That, in turn, may well compromise the national interests and security of small states.
On the second row, we have supply disruptions, which cover various types of disturbances in small states' flow security. That refers to their ability to guarantee that goods, products, technologies, and so on move on and to the country without major problems. Given great powers' supply chain dominance, they are more capable than other actors in causing these issues through actions such as turning choke points and hubs into political weapons. In the extreme, a single small state or a group of states may become a target of political retaliation, which is evident in the case of discrimination or sanctions. In addition, over-concentration of supply may in itself create supply disruptions, even if all parties try to avoid them.
And then if we look at the third row category, critical technology dependencies, that those cover situations in which vast human suffering and economic losses may be caused by cutoffs in the availability and functioning of technology. And because of great powers' core technology control, there's a relationship of asymmetric interdependence that exposes small states to the goodwill and abilities of great powers in safeguarding the delivery, maintenance, and information security of technologies, devices, and their parts.
So please keep in mind the broad categories from the previous slides. You can find them on this slide on the left side. This table represents the mini scenarios we created on our three broad risk categories. Scenarios illustrating security risk of foreign ownership included a mobile game company gathering personal data, the Arctic blast picture there, transfer of real estate ownership in Lapland, and venture capital investments in a quantum computing firm. These were short-term scenarios extending up to 2027.
And then the scenarios on supply disruptions dealt with discriminatory practices limiting access to antibiotics, the one that you just saw. Then political retaliation limiting access to components of water management. And sanctions on wind power materials, components and minerals. With these scenarios, the target year was 2030, which gave the panelists a chance to think in mid-term futures.
Critical technology dependencies were illustrated with cases on F-35 fighter jets maintenance, cybersecurity of home dialysis machines, and supply of helium, which is needed in various scientific processes in the fields such as quantum computing, space technologies, medical imaging, and semiconductor production. These were longer-term scenarios extending as far as 2035.
And then we offer another glimpse of the future. This time we travel to the year 2027.
News, 31st May, 2027. Company acquisitions. Chinese-owned gaming company shares Finnish citizens' personal data through a hit game.
Hi Pekka, what's up?
I kinda got hooked on Arctic Blast. I'm starting to understand why everyone's playing this game. It's an AR game in which you roam the town and reclaim bases by de-icing them. You're supposed to take photos of places, create bases with your team, and then defend or attack them.
And it's free to play? If it's as good as they're saying, sure, I'll give it a try as well.
Yeah, you can play it anywhere. Join my team so I can give you some resources to start with. I'm still trying to keep the Lily statue on ice, even though I'm losing.
Ooh, the app is asking for a lot of permissions. Have you read the terms and conditions?
Dude, no one ever reads them. But the company was founded by Lovisa Niemelä, a Finnish woman with a strong track record of exporting Finnish games. One cool thing Ilmatar Games does is to always include some references to Finland in its games.
Bro, didn't you know? It's not a Finnish company any longer. It was sold to China in 2025.
Damn, I had no idea.
Then you probably didn't know either that gaming company acquisitions are not screened, meaning that the Finnish government doesn't make any risk assessments when Finnish companies sell their business outside the EU.
Risk assessments? But it's just a game.
Sure, but the game has access to your and many other Finnish people's personal data. In terms of Finland's national security, this could be risky because of surveillance of critical infrastructure, intelligence gathering on influential persons and decision makers, monitoring of crowd flows, and other possible unpleasant surprises that we haven't even thought of.
Oh, wow! So, how could these risks have been avoided?
Firstly...
And then we get to our expert views. Based on the expert discussion, we were able to formulate three generic approaches to small state preparedness. They can be labeled as protectionist / interventionist approach, liberal approach, and technology-oriented approach. All these approaches could be found in both Finnish and Swedish exercises, but the degree to which they were present in different scenarios varied a great deal.
These approaches are heuristic in nature, and it's really also important to note that they are quite contextual. So linked tightly to the small state perspective. In other words, someone who has suggested solutions we have labeled here as protectionist might well support economic openness in principle, but may feel that small countries don't really have any other option under the current circumstances to go with the flow and follow the great powers in their increasingly protectionist policies. And given the relatively liberal nature of our empirical settings, that is Finnish and Swedish economies, basically any novel regulatory effort could be viewed as shift towards protectionism.
Yes, and it's also important to note that although these three approaches prioritize different key solutions for enhancing small state preparedness, they represent generic approaches rather than ready-made sets of policy recommendations. For this reason, we argue that ideally, states can formulate their own pick-and-mix toolkit by combining elements for all these approaches. This complementary nature of some of the suggested expert views was also visible in that many, even most, respondents argued for diversification as a solution to various challenges. What is more, elements from all approaches could sometimes be found even within the same expert comment.
So a few more things about protectionism slash interventionism. This approach refers to views that would like to expand the state's powers in controlling, guiding, and limiting economic activities. The experts gave a long list of concrete examples, of which we have collected here a few ones, but you can find more of them in the report. The examples we want to highlight here are covering acquisitions and greenfield investments in national foreign direct investment screening, screening venture capital investments in emerging technologies, imposing country-specific limitations to real estate acquisitions, and this was really popular among most of the expert comments. Friendshoring the production of critical goods, something the US policymakers are suggesting quite frequently nowadays, expanding the scope of stockpiling in pharmaceuticals and water treatment components. This view was most dominant in the real estate acquisition scenario and equally present in both countries.
And then the second approach, liberal approach, refers to a cluster of expert views that emphasized relying on carrots instead of sticks in enhancing small state preparedness. In practice, liberal ideas offer alternatives to limiting freedoms of entrepreneurs and interfering with the dynamics of the capitalist market economy. Concrete examples of this cluster of views included initiating value debates to guide individuals' choices in accepting investments, formulating a national innovation strategy to boost domestic companies' operating conditions in emerging technology fields, diversifying the sources of critical products, such as antibiotics, enhancing risk awareness and making plan Bs in supply chain management, and then also negotiating and discussing with China. This approach was most dominant in the scenarios in which a Finnish game company was acquired by a Chinese company and in which a Chinese investor made a capital investment in a Finnish quantum computing startup. Many respondents clearly wanted to refrain from any excessive control that would limit the freedoms of Finnish companies. This approach was equally present in both countries, but since the Finnish panel had plenty of participants from business, freedoms of entrepreneurs were more vividly emphasized there. Sweden's state official-dominated panel, in turn, often emphasized Sweden's agency to negotiate and discuss with China. And quite interestingly, that voice was almost silent in the Finnish panel.
And last but not least, we have the technology-oriented approach, which is quite common in future studies scenarios. This approach relies on new innovations or technical solutions. Some of the examples we gathered from the report include innovating new medicines to replace antibiotics, prioritizing non-conventional technologies such as small modular reactors, enhancing domestic capacity to produce components with 3D printing, researching alternative materials to replace critical chemicals, adopting geofencing and coding solutions to enhance cybersecurity, increasing the adaptability of technical solutions through standardization. This view was quite dominant in the game company example, which you already saw, in a scenario looking at water management materials, one related to helium and its supply security, and one which you are going to see in the end on home dialysis machines and their cybersecurity. So this view kind of thinks that problems created by technology can also be solved with technology. And these tech experts were, we had more of them in the Finnish panel, so this view was also most visible in the Finnish data.
Yeah, and we got very detailed comments, very specific comments from the technology.
Some of them were really even hard to understand for ourselves.
It's a time to get through them.
And then some final words, some words of conclusion. Our overall outcome is that small states really have options when it comes to designing their approaches preparedness, national preparedness. They have, on the broader term, on broader terms, least leeway in navigating the risk environments created by technological dependencies, whereas there are more extensive toolkits to tackle the potential dangers of foreign ownership and supply disruptions. States can apply a pick and mix strategy under the current circumstances to react to the current challenges. And there is also always a tension between maintaining openness and managing risks. You cannot kind of be too cakeist here. One thing that is really important to note also is that adopting policies and means shape state identities over time. Nothing comes for free, so if you make your legislative environment stricter, you might lose some investments like as a result.
That was something that a Swedish panelist very strongly emphasized. Nothing is for free.
And with this research, we wish to encourage democratic discussion on broader political choice. What type of state and economy do states and Finland and Sweden wish to be in the future? So as there are no one solution rather than many, we should continue having the discussion of which solutions we go for.
And then, in addition to gathering concrete solutions for enhancing small state preparedness, we of course wanted to raise risk awareness with this exercise. And reportedly, we were quite able to do so among many of our experts. That became quite clear due to direct feedback that we got at the end of the exercises, and also by email. We got various emails saying that people had changed their viewpoints on their responsibility as investors and as CEOs of Chinese-owned companies. The discussion during the exercises was also very active, and we had very high response rates for Delphi studies in our online questionnaires. To a large extent, that was also probably due to the constant reminders that we kept on sending very often. But it's also, I think, useful to point out that participating in this exercise might have strengthened some experts' risk perceptions of China and foreign investments more than we actually intended. However, because the panelists could at all times see each other's answers and comments, they were exposed to various arguments that definitely hailed the benefits and significance of foreign investments and emphasized the country-neutral nature of many of the proposed risks. So that way, we feel that balanced the flaws of our sort of bias that we probably expressed. And sometimes some of the individual panelists were also able to sober up the discussion, as you can see from the following quote. Not all responsibility can be shifted solely under restrictions imposed by authorities. Having suspicions or an unpleasant feeling about certain acquisitions is not enough to block transfers or take over properties. Instead, there must be something tangible. In Finland, all decisions can be appealed and the courts must be convinced by the authorities' justification. Mere citizenship is currently not enough to prevent acquisitions. Although the current general atmosphere demands blood in the arena, this is not delivered based on public uproar, and that is why Finland differs from authoritarian states. And then finally, we wish to end this presentation with a risk awareness and futures-oriented mindset by ending the journey in year 2035.
News, 4th of July, 2035. High technology risks. Chinese home dialysis machines targeted by cyber attack. Backlogs in public healthcare.
How are things here?
Ooh, hi Mika. So glad to see the next shift arriving. You won't believe how busy I've been.
Busier than usual.
You bet. We've had all these home dialysis patients coming in very poor shape. Their condition had just suddenly deteriorated. The whole emergency department is in mayhem.
Wow, that's weird.
Yeah, I've never seen something like this before. Later.
Thank you for coming at such a short notice. This need for an extra meeting came up quite suddenly. Since yesterday evening, kidney disease patients have been turning up to the emergency department with pulmonary edema and arrhythmia, and their lab results have been abnormal. At the same time, though, the log data received from the home dialysis machines have been completely normal.
The same thing is happening in Sweden. I was just talking to a colleague this morning and we were equally confused.
How's our staff coping with the increased workload? We also have a skills shortage because dialysis patients are treated at home nowadays.
The latest update was installed on the machines 2 days ago without issues. Taiyang hasn't informed us of any problems. Taiyang won the contract with us not only for its cost effectiveness, but also for its strong cybersecurity expertise. Each device is connected to a secured network. It's hard to believe the problem would be in the devices. In any case, I'll discuss this with Taiyang's IT contact person as soon as possible.
Pulmonary edema can be caused by many other factors. We'll investigate the matter.
In the morning.
Hi, Mika. Feeling tired?
Welcome to the battle zone, Pete. Lena and I have done a double shift in emergency and transferred multiple kidney patients to the ward. We have been rushed off our feet all night.
Have you heard anything from the management?
They are suspecting that the problem is in the home dialysis machines. They may have been sending incorrect values to us. And here we have thought that the treatments have been going fine as usual.
In the meantime.
So, it seems that home dialysis machines can be manipulated to transmit false data. I'm suspecting that that might be the case here. But Taiyang denies that there is any problem with their machines.
I've said this before. Chinese companies are a risk. Corruption, lack of transparency, crackdowns on big companies.
But you yourself argued that China produces high-quality healthcare technology more cost-effectively than others. There was a clear change in the late 2020s when China shifted from a bulk commodity exporter to a high-technology producer.
Indeed. Back in 2027, there was also an incident in France where the oxygen home use ventilators were compromised. The risks are always present.
You know, cost effectiveness!
The transition was speeded up because of the nurse shortages.
What about public tendering rules?
Hey, the paramedics just brought in another blue-lipped patient.
I guess that's the end of our break. Back to work, then.
I just got news. A South Asian hacker group is behind this. It's blackmailing Taiyang. They injected malware into the update, and it will disrupt the machine's functions until the company pays the ransom.
I wonder how we'll manage to find enough dialysis machines for all the patients.
Or enough personnel.
Has the ransom been paid?
What kind of poverty, greed, or wickedness drives people to do something so unethical?
And what kind of company tries to hide such a thing?
And how on earth could this situation have been avoided?
Thank you very much. And ending on that video note, I would like to ask then Professor Emerita Sirkka Heinonen to give her comments and remarks on the presentation. Please.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the introduction and the invitation to come to this seminar, and congratulations on the study and the publication of the report. It's really amazing, but I have to mention here that I'm external commentator, so visiting commentator, even though I come from the University of Turku as well. So I'm giving these commentary remarks from the perspective of future studies, obviously, and it is very remarkable that future studies approach and methods have been applied in this study. It is not self-evident because, for the audience to know, perhaps some of you don't know that future studies is already an academic discipline in University of Turku, and it is very rare worldwide. So from 2013 we got the status of department, and I'm happy to learn that Liisa Kauppila actually is one of our alumni in our master's program. But future studies, it is also a possibility for any discipline: international affairs, political studies, medicine, engineering, whatever the study is, it could apply future studies methods. And now I'm going to give a few comments about the way you applied future studies methodology here. We recommend using hybrid methods, and you have done it very well. You have a hybrid methodology using scenarios. They are here mini scenarios, I would call. Then Delphi and backcasting. And of course, when we think about methodology and especially Delphi, you also very well emphasized dissensus and not the consensus, as it was first started when Delphi technique was established. And of course, the idea of the Delphi method goes back to the ancient world. Delphi Oracle was a political institution. Statesmen went to ask for help from the Oracle. In modern future studies, we are using experts' views, and you used very well this kind of dissensus approach. But I would have liked to see more emphasis on the outliers' view. You very well compiled and presented the views of experts and clustered them. But perhaps in continuation, you could pick up some of the outliers' views, because then it will broaden and open up perhaps more opportunities. And about this backcasting approach, which is also very interesting, and I'm pleased that you used that backcasting approach. We are jumping to the future, and there is a future state or future image, and then we go backwards, like trying to find what measures had to be done. And you chose to use dystopias. So the measures required were those that prevent those dystopian futures happening. Usually backcasting is used in a normative approach. So we have a very desirable future at the end, and we try to ask experts to think the measures, how we can push forward to this. But I liked your approach because it's somehow perhaps more inspirational to the experts as well. A few comments more. The use of visuals, these comics, the use of arts in presenting results and in communicating findings is a very important way of communicating results. Actually, it would be recommended that each research report would include some kind of means of art or media in transmitting the results, especially stakeholders. They are eager to not to read very long reports. Of course, we have to have all the material then, but how to communicate. It's about science communication, using the art more and more. But about a few constructively critical comments here as a conclusion. Perhaps some kind of futures table could have been in place where you present those drivers depending on fast change and slow change. And on the other hand, on the agency of public sector and private sector. Then you could have a structural like presentation. There are very fast changes, attacks, tariffs, restrictions made, but also very slow change drivers like in ideologies or cultural things. So this kind of differentiation would perhaps be, you could even use this material and make it when you communicate the results. And then at the final pages of the report, I saw the word vision. And actually, in experts' views perhaps, and in your own views, you posed the question, what type of state do Finland and Sweden and small states wish to be? So that is the vision that is really much needed in future studies. And I could recommend that this kind of visionary work would be done in the very first phases of a study. In your next study, please jump right to this vision part. And then the vision has to be jointly created and shared, but it can be modified according to changing circumstances, of course. But it's all about values, principles, and small state, how they can preserve their values of democracy, openness, transparency, etc. And perhaps still one more. You already had fantastically a hybrid combination of different future studies methods here, but for the next studies that you will be doing, I would warmly recommend using CLA, causal layered analysis. And in the morning talks, I heard a lot about talk about perception of China, perception of state activities and how it has an impact on reality. So CLA is a method that deconstructs litanies, rhetorics, what is being said on politics and states. Then it goes on to study systemic cause and effect relations, worldviews, and finally metaphors. So what is the metaphor for China? What is a metaphor for Finland as an actor in geopolitics? Thank you very much.
Thank you. And then I would like to ask our commentator and also Professor Breslin to take your seats on the panel. I will let our previous speakers respond to the remarks, but just remind you that after that, you will have the possibility now to pose questions directly here, or again, remind you also about the bowl there. So if you don't want to pose it in front of everyone, you can just put it in the bowl as well. Just scribble it on the paper and put it in the bowl. But be prepared with questions in a few moments. So.
Many thanks, Professor Heinonen, for these excellent and really insightful comments. Yes, the future table would be something we should definitely think about. We are still going to do some academic publications based on the same data, so we can apply these comments for at least two or three of the papers that we are currently drafting, and perhaps you if you have time, we would of course like to offer the opportunity to read some of the drafts, so perhaps then we could get them through academic journals. Yes, fast and slow developments. It wasn't an easy task to decide on the years of some of these developments. For instance, the antibiotic scenario, which we showed you in the beginning, some of the experts commented that it could have already happened today because of the current situation. So it wasn't so much futuristic. But with some of the others, you could have sort of placed them to any of our selected years, and sometimes we had different reasons of choosing the topic. So methodologically, that's a challenge when you try to do many things at the same time.
Okay, I'll continue from where Elina left. Thank you very much for the comment. It was very nice to get comments that I agree with completely. So about the outliers, that has been an issue that we've been tackling, and definitely there are outliers, and we would need to find a way to discuss sort of those means that don't really fit these broad categories. And also sometimes it actually is quite difficult to place an expert succession either to a protectionist, interventionist, or to a liberal category, because it really is sort of a thin line between them sometimes in this context. Yes, vision. We've been sort of wanting to emphasize that Finland should have a vision for enhancing small state preparedness, although we of course also basically proposed that pick and mix strategy should be adopted, but we still think that there should be some kind of underlying vision. And basically, if we were able to participate in the work of doing that, of drafting that kind of vision, we'd be very enthusiastic to do so. Well, maybe one more comment. It was great that you mentioned CLA. My next projects are going to be futures-oriented projects as well. And we had the chance to include Sohail Inayatullah, the developer of the method, in that project. So I'm definitely going to be very interested in learning to apply that method. Yes, we got funding from Business Finland to study great power rivalry in standardization activities. And that's going to be 2035. And we're going to be starting, continuing with this art and science, art meets science format. Then I'm engaged in a kind of foundation project that tries to bring climate responsibility as the cornerstone of international collaboration. That's another futures research-oriented project in the Arctic. And then the last one, which entails Sohail Inayatullah, is about non-human approaches to IR in the Arctic region. Very futures-oriented project, extends up to 2050. So.
Great, thank you. Just to remind you about this, so the purpose of the bill was that in the last panel discussion, these questions will then be dealt with, but you need to put them in the bowl by around 2 o'clock at the latest. So after that we will start processing these questions. Now I turn over to the floor, the audience. We have approximately, well, almost 20 minutes here of time for direct questions, comments from the audience. Any immediate wish to respond to any of the presentations or comments? Actually, you can ask any one of the panelists. Myself. Thank you. Very good questions. The latter two were to the panelists, but I think I can start with responding to the first one because that's maybe more my turf. So I guess the short answer to your question, why we focused on the EU and in particular Nordic countries, is that there was this new round of funding for the Academy of Finland that very much had this sort of in the background, sort of Finland's crisis preparedness and resilience and so on. And I had been working a little bit on that, so it was just focus on your strengths, play to your strengths. But why these kinds of investments and not, for example, infrastructure? It's true that the Tallinn was talked about, but a lot of its critical infrastructure investments, in particular here in the Nordic countries, have not really been realized. They haven't come to fruition. So we looked more at what was happening, which were company acquisitions. That's where you had actually money flowing in. And later on, we have had more, a little bit more of greenfield investment and so on. But the infrastructure part is more talk than actual sort of money flowing, at least at that time. Thank you. And then I guess at least Lisa and Elina have a lot to say about the other two questions, perhaps the other panelists as well.
Yeah, so basically, I could start with the human rights question. We formulated a very versatile panel. We made sure to have sort of perspectives from all political parties, from various types of NGOs. We had the scenario that took place in Lapland, so we made sure to have good Sami representation. I also think entrepreneurial rights are human rights questions, so I think that was also one way to incorporate the human rights as perspective there to sort of hear what the entrepreneurs had to say about their position. But yeah, so basically I think the way to get that perspective and many others was to pay very much attention to selecting the panel. I phoned most of the panelists and the ones that we knew really well, we only contacted by email with a personalized email. But that was sort of the most sort of exhaustive phase of the study to really make sure that all these different sort of voices in society are covered.
Then I could say a few words about why there was least leeway in the high-tech cases, where the three cases that we selected for this report cover the F-35s, which are really a tech that can only be produced in the US by one company and it's and also the other were like health risk, even human lives were in danger in these scenarios. So even though Finland has a lot of high tech knowledge, not all the tech can be considered important when it comes to life-threatening situations. So we have had national security, which wasn't otherwise a core theme in this project. Then we had health sector, and And then the helium thing is, of course, more kind of futures oriented, and there was less of life-threatening situation, but there was the environmental point raised a little bit, that if we can't get enough helium, then we would need it for crisis prevention or climate change related technologies as well. So that was one theme. Why, Sanova?
So yeah, we basically focused on highest technology. So we really focused on F-35s and also life-supporting machines. And I've been doing a lot of company interviews in the health sector as part of this project as well. And I learned that it's actually very concentrated, the production. And small states don't tend to do that because it's a major investment. And it's so basically...
So if I can add on just... obviously... countries like Sweden and Finland have a lot of high-tech as well, companies doing high-tech, but here we focused on specific sort of areas of technology where it's very concentrated, where very few suppliers, and it might be just China and India or China and the US that supplies most of whatever small component it is, so there are not many options available.
And then the risk here, for instance, in the dialysis scenario, is formed through a domestic weakness. We don't have enough personnel. We want to have machines doing the jobs that the nurses used to do, and our tendering rules are such that we go for the cheapest option, and then we ended up in a situation like this. So the blame wasn't on the producer, it was also our own weaknesses that created the risk scenario. So this was also discussed in there. So
yeah,
just to point out related to the China threats that can be raised through.
And also one more thing, we did choose Finland and Sweden as cases, but many of our findings would also actually apply to some small states in Africa as well. There are limitations, but I've noticed that a lot of our findings are actually quite universal if you just sort of, yeah, take into consideration certain differences.
We have time for at least one more round of questions, so be brave, raise your hand, ask a question if you have one. On the first question, do you want to say something?
Yeah, I would. I mean, the specific Trump presidency wasn't there, but that was the whole point of the slide about pressure, right, to some extent. I mean, I can't speak for Finland, obviously, but one of the things we did talk about in the report was the fact that it could be the country's response to China that affects security rather than the direct China issue. And in conversations I've had in the UK, one of the things that comes across is people saying that, look, we've always had to take Chinese politics seriously and look at that and how that might affect our business operations. But now we have to look at American politics, and we have to look at British politics and German politics and European politics, and how their response to China might affect our ability to trade. But it's certainly true that we are in a period, I think, across the continent to different degrees of... I'm not sure what word to use. A focus on China to the extent that I've not seen in the past since perhaps 1989, and that didn't last very long in 1989. So perhaps there is something in what you say about the importance of not becoming too focused on the China side of things and moving to other potential focuses of insecurity too. The specifics of the Finnish case, I don't know, but what you just said sounded very much like what I flew away from a couple of days ago, if that makes any sense.
And I can maybe continue from there on. I often say when I advise students writing their thesis that if you end up in the end with where you started, then you might not have done your research.
So we should not know in advance when we start the project where we end up to. That's the whole point of doing research, that we discover something new that we didn't think of. And I think what became abundantly clear really is during this project that we also had to reevaluate a lot of our assumptions. And I think you see it in those publications that we have put out, many of the papers, that if you look at the sheer numbers, as Sean was saying, it's minuscule in a lot of EU countries, for example, and the UK as well, Chinese investment currently. So why is Denmark changing or introducing screening procedures when there's almost no Chinese investment in Denmark? It's an interesting question. We have been very much sort of aware of this thing, but as a bit of a discrepancy also when you want to or need to participate in a public debate that expects that this is a huge problem and a huge risk. And you might say, as Sean was saying, that actually political risks are not just related to China, not even just related to the US, but we have political risks related to a number of countries that we know very well as well.
I just want to, very quickly, I think one of the things that really struck me about not just this, but also perhaps wider discussions, was that Russia doesn't seem to get the attention that I expected it to get. So even when we're talking about Russia and Ukraine, often, at least again back in the UK, the focus then quickly turns to, so what would happen if China invades Taiwan? So even when we're talking about Russia, it's amazing how quickly that conversation turns to China. Sorry.
About the dependencies and how China was presented and why our examples dealt with China. Actually, if you look through the whole of our 9 scenarios, we also have cases on US dependencies, like the F-35 maintenance problem that we have. So we didn't have space to go through all of them, but we wanted to bring out some of those dependencies as well. And there is also one in the water treatment system where we had equal dependence on both of the superpowers, but we just didn't have European production available. So there is that angle. And in some of the dynamics, if you read through all of the scenarios, there is a little bit of this great power competition. So it's not just China, it's the combination and the rivalry of the two that create the problematic situation for Finland.
Very briefly, do you want to respond to the last question on the strategy recommendations?
Is that the same as policy recommendations?
I guess it is. And then maybe can I say here that maybe you could respond, and perhaps Sirkka as an outsider also has something to say. How did you read the policy recommendations when you looked at the report? But you can, I mean, Lisa, you can start first and then we go with Sirkka.
I'm going to be giving quite a bit of policy recommendations in my next presentation, so I might take the time then.
Well, I think it was a relevant question to ask for strategy. Policy recommendations, of course, but strategy is a more comprehensive, like where next, and this also should include forward-looking, very long-term horizon. So that's certainly needed and recommended to be included.
Yes, we will have the final panel that hopefully will discuss this, where to move next, and what was left out of the report, some of the big themes. So please stay until the end. More comments are coming.
Stay tuned for the grande finale. Yes. With that, I think we have to conclude the first session today. Thank you very much. Thank you, all panelists. And lunch will be served outside here on the left-hand side. So final hand of applause.